back to our guest today, Hannah Waterson. Hannah, let's now talk about the skills shortage, because we hear about it in every aspect of business. Is it an impact in the PR business in general?
Definitely, and particularly when you are working in a specialist area, having somebody with that knowledge is difficult. We've been lucky though, we always seem to have the right number of people around for the workload that we have. I mean, we manage the business very carefully to make sure we have that balance of capacity and workload. But yes, I know for a lot of our colleagues out there in the industry, they could find themselves advertising in other countries trying to bring people across, and obviously there's a lot of poaching that goes on and among consultancies.
So we'll talk about poaching in a second, but how do you attract your staff?
Well, every once in a while we will just see people that we like out there in the industry, and if we have a space for them, we'll approach them and try and get them to come and join us, poaching. But no, more often than not, it's really from advertising. We advertise in the normal places, we look at the CVs, get people in, and if we think they have got the personal attributes that we reckon will make a good consultant and fit well within our team, then we don't mind teaching them as far as the skills are concerned.
So if poaching is such a problem in the industry, or if it's running rife, how do you retain your employees and make sure they stick with you?
It's about providing the right environment. I mean, we are really determined to make sure that we have a good balance between work and home. A lot of consultancies, just because of the pressures of their cost structure, because of their multinational setups and their head offices and other areas, they will be working their consultants from 8 till 10, from 8 till 6 every day. I don't think it's right. I think people need to be able to come to work hard while they're there, but be able to go home and enjoy themselves. You need that balance. And the sort of people that end up coming to us are the people that want that balance themselves.
There are lots of PR businesses out there, and we definitely know that on the show here. We've had quite a few, and it's interesting to see the different personalities come along. We've had people that are just loud and yabba yabba yabba, like to talk and be loud. How different is your company to the other PR businesses out there, and how do you set yourself different apart from everyone else?
Well, I mean, we like to have fun like the others, but yeah, I don't think you'd ever call me bubbly. We set ourselves apart with our senior level of service. We, you know, determined when, again, I set the business up to make sure we had senior people servicing clients. Too often in a big consultancy, a client will actually get handed down the line, and after some time will find themselves being serviced by a junior.
Oh, does that happen?
That happens.
Okay.
And that's when we then get those companies coming to us saying, that's been my previous experience, I don't want that again. If I come to you, I want to know that I'm going to have a senior consultant.
Why do you think that happens?
I think it happens because a lot of these consultancies, they have clients coming in and going out, so they need to show their senior clients to the new clients that they met. Sorry, they need to show their senior consultants to the new clients. They need to have senior people in there establishing the programs. Once everything's up and running smoothly, it's easier for the more junior personnel to take those programs over, and then the consultancy will use their senior staff to attract more new business.
Okay, and that's something you're trying not to do, though?
We don't do. We have more senior people than junior. I think senior service is a way of differentiating yourselves, particularly when you're a local independent consultancy competing with the big multinationals.
Does that mean running the business would be a higher cost to these other PR companies that have more juniors, I guess?
No, I think they will probably have a better cost ratio. I think they're probably more profitable than us because they obviously pay their junior people less, but they're still charging good rates. But, you know, at the same time, we all have to provide a service that's actually going to meet the needs of the clients. And I would rather cut back on the profit a little bit to make sure that I've got clients that are happy and stay with us. We've had clients for more than 10 years. And we've been through all sorts of different states of technology. We've learned all about different markets for them. We've done all sorts of communication from media through industry analysts, customers, investors, etc. And I think the reason these people stick with us and take us through all these changes in their business is because we have senior people that know them, understand them, and are very effective very quickly.
So how much money is there to be made in public relations?
It's a good profitable business if you run it correctly. Having said that, I think it's areas like politics, crisis management. These are the sections which probably attract the larger money because those are the more higher risk areas.
Right. And in terms of where you make your money, where do you tend to pull the money in from the business? Where's your profit margins coming from?
Oh, it's from consulting. I mean, that's all we have to sell is our time and expertise.
Mm.
We don't put markups, for example, on expenses. I mean, that's another way we try to differentiate ourselves in the marketplace. So what we sell is our time, our expertise, and we have to make sure that we have people working a minimum number of hours per day to be able to have the business run profitably. But at the same time, that doesn't mean they have to be working extended hours. hours. We try and fit that within a normal working day so they have that balance.
Can you run us through some of your bigger clients and what some of the most interesting campaigns you've done so far?
Well, the campaigns are always fun. One of the first campaigns I worked on was with a company called Silicon Graphics. We don't represent them now, but that was big graphics workstations. And we were doing work for their special effects area, which was being used on movies like Terminator and The Mask. It was great fun, Jurassic Park. Mm. So, you know, you're taking journalists out to see these movies with these wonderful special effects. And this is before they were common. It was something really different. And being able to get great photographs, great spreads and publications was not hard because we had these wonderful images to work with. At the same time, we were also promoting them into the medical imaging area, into computer-aided design and manufacturing. So you had that solid story going at the same time. So there was a lot of satisfaction. We work with companies like Nortel in the communications area. And, you know, you've gone from straight handsets on your desk through to wireless internet, mobile phones, hyperconnectivity, everything's connected. It's fantastic. GE with finance is amazing too. And again, you know, being set the job of being able to break into a particular market with education pieces, with letting people understand the benefits through talking to our clients' customers and using their real life experiences has really helped us.
For those small and medium enterprises out there that try to think that, hey, we can do our own PR, we'll handle it ourselves, what do you think they're missing out on by not outsourcing that side of the business?
Well, normally a person that starts a small business is a specialist in a particular area, whether it's a product or a service. They're not a specialist in PR. And what we see over and over again is these companies come in, they set up their own business, a bit like me, not being able to do my own accounting. You know, fine, I was doing the consulting, but I don't understand how to run my own network. I don't know how to do my own accounts. I needed to hire those services in. And it's the same way with other SMEs. They can't market themselves, but they need to. They need to tell people who they are, what they do, what their competitive edge is over somebody else. And that's where they really should be using their marketing and PR.
And I guess just finally, and you pointed it out at the very beginning of the interview, getting your work-life balance right. How do you do it?
Well, it takes discipline. I mean, even though I did start up my own business, you know, originally I was only going to work school hours and a few days a week. And my five-year-old, God love him, after about 2 weeks, was telling me off because the other kids got to go to after-school care. Why didn't he? So he started going to after-school care. I started working longer hours. And, you know, at one point he actually came to me and said, you're like a reverse ghost. We only ever see you in the mornings.
Oh, okay.
So you have to stop, you have to work hard. You've got to say, these are the hours that I work. You've got to know what your kids' schedules are and make sure that you're out there at the events, you know, taking them to their sporting things. And when you are owning your own business, obviously you have that flexibility. And I try and give that same flexibility to my staff.